I'm Wes Solem. I'm a genetic counselor from HD Genetics, a company dedicated to providing remote genetic counseling and genetic testing options for the HD community. Today, I'm here on behalf of HDYO, the Huntington's Disease Youth Organization, for a series called HDYou, to share stories from the HD community. These stories are told by and for the HD community. Deciding to test for HD is one of the biggest decisions someone at risk for HD can face. And today we're going to hear from Robyn, who tested positive for the genetic cause of Huntington's disease. Robyn, would you care sharing a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, so my name's Robyn and I am 33 years old and I'm based in the UK. And I tested positive for Huntington's disease about 13 years ago. And I have been a young carer for the last 15 years for my dad. He's got Huntington's disease. Obviously. And I got involved with the HDYO ambassadors about 18 months ago after doing a huge fundraising event dedicated to dad's life. I actually climbed Kilimanjaro and, you know, the whole thing was dedicated to dad's life and everything he'd been through and, you know, just to show him how much he meant to me. And obviously I wanted to raise money for Huntington's disease and that's how I ended up getting involved who are HDYO and joining them as an ambassador.
Awesome. Yeah, thank you. So just kind of broadly speaking, Robyn, how would you say that Huntington's disease has affected you?
It's been a really hard journey because dad is one of six. He's the youngest of all his siblings, but up until dad got diagnosed 15 years ago, we had no idea that Huntington's disease was in the family at all. So for us to get that diagnosis, obviously, you know, after a long battle with the NHS, like back and forth, you know, they were, his GP and think was adamant that there was nothing wrong with him for a long time. And we had to like constantly battle with them just to even get tests done at that point. So for us to get the diagnosis that, you know, he had Huntington's disease it was a relief because it meant that he was not, you know, like losing his mind really, like there was a reason for why he was feeling the way he was, or you know, to find out that was a hereditary disease completely threw the whole family off. So it wasn't like it was just dad and us going through it. It was every one of like his siblings then and all their kids and their grandkids. It was like this kind of domino effect that happened almost instantly for the whole family. So obviously, like 12 months after we found out that dad was diagnosed, I, you know, started to think about testing. But it was, you know, it wasn't just me going through it. It was, you know, aunties and uncles and siblings and cousins all at the exact same time. Everyone was kind of, you know, having those conversations at home with each other, you know, discussing, are they going to test and what their views were about it. And it was, you know, like you said at the start, you know, it's a very personal decision, isn't it, to test? And I think, you know, that was very, very, like shown in the family because there were so many people, you know, and everyone made a lot of different decisions. But it was a hard 12 months, I think, for everyone.
Yeah, gosh, it sounds like, you know, often in the HD community, sometimes folks are coming up with a family history of the disease and having kind of witnessed this and known that they're at risk. But it sounds like this came sort of as a surprise and affected all the family at once, which can be really, really tough. What ultimately kind of played into your decision to decide to test for yourself? What was sort of the tipping point for you of saying, you know what, I think that I want to test?
It was, do you know what, it's like, I obviously, you know, it was almost instantly from when dad, you know, got the diagnosis that I knew that I wanted to test. Mm-hmm. I'm very much like a worrier about a lot of things. And I knew that for me, the uncertainty of the not knowing would have been a bigger worry than obviously actually the testing process and finding out. You know, I think a lot of the time when people are at risk, you can kind of, if you've got that worry in mind, you know, back and forth, down different rabbit holes, like, do I, don't I kind of thing. And I just thought, you know what, like, as a young woman at the time, you know, I was like thinking ahead to the future. Like, I wanted to obviously think about family planning and all these things. And, you know, I think if I knew that, I obviously had tested positive in the, when I went through the testing process, then I could obviously make a plan, you know, like how I was going to, at least I knew for definite, and, you know, start making some changes and some steps to moving forward with that decision.
Okay, yeah. And did you, you know, having, you mentioned that basically your family was kind of all going through this process and everyone was sort of then thinking about this. Did you encounter folks having different opinions on seeking testing throughout your family? Were there folks that maybe did not want to test? Or, yeah.
It's crazy because, like, you know, I think it made me realize, like, how different a lot of people's opinions were on a lot of very raw and touching subjects, you know, even down to like my views on children, having children in the future, in terms of that to what my siblings think, you know, it's very different. And I had very strict views that I didn't want to bring a child into the world, you know, and with that, trying to give, like, trying to prevent that from happening to them, you know, in any possible way that I could, in terms of IVF or, you know, different avenues. So, you know, it was a lot of different decisions, even down to, you know, my siblings and stuff like that. Like, a lot of people were saying, like, they didn't want to test, whereas I was, like, adamant that I wanted to know. And I felt like, you know, even, you know, that I don't think at the time I was only, like, 19, 20, when I was going to get, I just got my results when I just turned 20. So, you know, I don't think my mum and that wanted me to particularly find out at that point. You know, they were worried for how it was gonna, you know, impact me, because obviously there's a lot of negativity and a lot of, like, heaviness that can come after that, you know, getting your results if they are positive. And I think they were just, you know, worried for me in that moment, but ultimately they knew the decision was mine, so, like, they trusted my judgment on it, even if they were, you know, worried about it. But they definitely did raise concerns.
Okay, yeah. So it sounds like they ended up ultimately supporting your decision and kind of being in your corner for that. Yeah. Okay. And how have things been over the last, you know, several years of you deciding to test, and then sort of how's it been for your family throughout then? Have people slowly tested, or did everyone kind of test?
Two years from dad's diagnosis, everyone had everyone who wanted to tested, and then obviously some of his siblings just said, listen, like, we don't want to know at that age. They knew they didn't have kids, so it wasn't really, they said, you know, it's not impacting anyone else, you know, if they find out or not, you know what I mean? So, but obviously his siblings who did have kids, they wanted to know, because obviously if they were positive, then it's their children, you know, who have to then think about those decisions as well. So it was almost everyone had kind of made the decision, you know, quite, you know, in a short space of time. And it felt like there was a lot of, you know, huge milestones happening in a very, very short space of time for the whole family.
Okay. Yeah. And for you, I mean, it sounds like you were pretty sure about seeking testing for yourself, and you sort of reached that decision of saying, you know what, this is what I want to do. Did you ever experience any sort of doubt, or like looking at it and sort of saying, I'm not really sure, or, you know, how long was that decision process for you, or were you pretty much instantly and completely like, nope, this is what I want to do?
Yeah, I think it was just like there was an instant feeling that I wanted to do it. But I think looking back, you know, at the time I was, you know, when you're that age, you think you're mature and you think you're grown up and all these things. But obviously I was mature enough to get, they decided that I was, like, they thought I was mature enough to get the results. But, you know, you're obviously looking back now, 10 years on or whatever, it's like, yeah, I don't think you realize you're not as mature as what you think at the time, are you? So I think maybe if I had any advice to my younger self, I'd probably say just take a bit longer, you know, to think about those decisions. And because it felt like it was almost, you know, just like it happened like overnight, just like in the blink of an eye. And it was like, I had to not only process the result of, you know, dad's getting diagnosed with that, and then what was coming in terms of, you know, us having to adapt at home and, you know, start caring for him and all these changes that was happening with dad, I was also having to process the results of my own, you know, of the testing process. So it was a lot, I think, for, you know, a 20-year-old to handle at that time. And I don't think I handled it very well for a long time. You know, I really, really did struggle with my mental health for you know, I'd say for a good few years after it, you know. And, you know, things did get quite dark for a long time. And I had to, you know, seek professional help, you know, from a therapist and stuff. And I ended up staying with her for about 8 years because, you know, I just needed like that. Even though I'd, you know, she, like, it's kind of, I think, you know, with Huntington's, it's like you go through a lot of like very ups and downs, like a lot of like ups and downs, don't you, emotionally. So I needed that support. And I did have to see, you know, help in the end to get some help in terms of me how my mental health was.
Sure. Did you have that kind of help going into it? Were you seeing a counselor or anything prior to testing, or was this after the fact?
No, to be honest with you, like, obviously, you know, I didn't really have any support. The only support system that I really had was my family and like my friends and stuff. I didn't have any, you know, mental health support before it. And I think that would probably be, you know, something that I look back on thinking, you know, if I could have done something differently, I probably would have, you know, sought out help before it, you know, like an actual therapist, be like to like literally like go through the whole process with, you know, and kind of do a bit of a debrief after the results in terms of just processing, you know, how I was feeling in those moments and those raw emotions and stuff. And I think, as a 20-year-old, I don't think I was processing those very intense emotions that was coming after those results well at all. And I think, you know, support from a therapist afterwards, that immediately after my results, I think probably would have saved me, you know, a lot of struggle after the, you know, after the fact.
Yeah, what led to your ultimate decision to seeking a therapist after your testing? What was sort of that that decision point of saying, you know what, I need to talk to someone professionally?
It was hard because I kind of kept it secret, you know, to a lot of people that I obviously had Huntington's disease. And I think, you know, it wasn't, you know, at the time I didn't think consciously, oh, I don't want anyone to know the results. It was more, you know, the actual having to have those conversations with everyone. It's like, you know, looking back now, I can reflect on it, and I know that, you know, having those conversations over and over again with people, it takes a lot of energy from you, you know, to like constantly be having it. And I don't think it wasn't the fact that I didn't want them to know, but, you know, constantly having to go over it again with people, and it felt like you were having the same conversation on repeat with a lot of, you know, people who, and obviously everyone was only, you know, like looking out for me and like, you know, concerned for me. It was like, it did take a toll on me, you know, constantly having to say to people, oh yeah, this is what happened, and you know, I tested positive. And it's like, you know, it felt like I was just, you know, have like repeating conversations over and over again a lot of the time. So it got to the point where I ended up just, you know, not telling people for a long time. I kept it a secret for a long time. And I think in the moment, I thought I was kind of protecting myself. But what I was actually doing was kind of hindering myself, you know. I think, you know, now, you know, you kind of get wisdom as you get older and stuff like that. And, you know, you can look back on it and see that, you know, that definitely was not the best decision in the moment, because, you know, keeping a secret from everyone around me kind of just put a big weight, a lot of weight and a lot of heaviness on me. And, you know, it's only been recently where I've actually started sharing my story and telling people, like within like the last couple of years, no one really knew apart from me, my family and I meet like close friends. So, you know, it was hard to just like start telling people, but it's been really freeing at the same time, you know, opening up to people and like you know, a lot of people don't get it, and a lot of people don't understand what Huntington's disease is, and that just comes with the like with the thing. But it took a lot of weight off my shoulders, and you know, mm-hmm. I don't feel like I'm carrying this secret anymore, and I kind of just it helped me accept the diagnosis and the results, you know, completely being open with people and sharing that. Because at the end of the day, like it's not going to change anything, you know, like not no matter what I can do can change those that result. So I think mm-hmm. the sooner like we start accepting it and like, you know, being open with people about it, you know, it helps a lot.
Yeah. Have you noticed any sort of difference in whenever you're sharing this information with people now versus whenever you were sharing with people shortly after learning that you tested positive? Like maybe in the sense of how you're explaining it or how you're relating your own personal risk and what that means emotionally, or how you describe it, either way.
Yeah, I think, to be honest with you, it's not even that it's actually changed, but I think the way I view it, and I view myself, and I mm-hmm. view, you know, the like that result, it has changed. You know, like there was a lot of shame and a lot mm-hmm. of like negativity around mm-hmm. it. And I think I hadn't like completely, you know, embraced it. Whereas now I feel like I'm, you know, it's hard, and it is really hard living with Huntington's disease, but I'm also, you know, really proud of everything I've been through, and, you know, mm-hmm. everything I've done, and, you know, coming through all, sorry, I'm going to get teary.
Okay.
You know, I really struggled for a long time after those results, and to be in a place now where I can talk about it freely and be open to people and, you know, start sharing my story to help other people. It's been a blessing. It really has.
That's good. Yeah. Yeah. I imagine that there's been quite the emotional journey in receiving your results, and then kind of, as we often hear described, integrate that into your life and kind of have that be a part of your life, from knowing your risk to actually learning the results and what that may mean for you. It sounds like that's changed over time. Can you let me know your kind of decision for seeking genetic testing for Huntington's disease and sort of everything that went into the actual process? What did that look like for you? Like from the point of deciding, okay, I do want to move forward with genetic testing, kind of, I guess, like, did you decide that, and then did you reach out the next day, the next week, the next month? Like, what did that process look like for you? Did you go through a formal kind of genetic counseling process, or was this through a doctor, or like, what did it look like?
Yeah, so I actually spoke to Dr. Davies, the neurologist who diagnosed Dad, and he actually runs the HDYO here in Liverpool.
Oh, good.
So obviously, like, I told him, you know, like, that I was thinking about it, and he said, like, you know, put me in touch with someone to like get help professionally. So I went through the NHS here, and I went to see my GP, and they set it up all up for me. And, you know, even when I spoke to the doctor, they were kind of like, you know, you're only young, and, you know, this is like quite a serious process and stuff, like, you know, are you ready for it? And I said, well, at that time I did feel like I was ready for it, but I just said, like, you know, I think it's one of those processes, until you're in it and you're going through it, like, you're not, like, you know, you're not going to know like what it's going to feel like until you're actually in there. So I said, you know what, I said, let's just start the process. And obviously, if we decide at the time or halfway through it that it's going to be too much, then that was obviously a judgment call that I was going to make as and when, like, you know, as the sessions went, kind of, rather than, you know, immediately make any hasty decisions or whatever. So I kind of took each session as it went. And from the offset, you know, the whole process was, it was really, went really well. I felt like really, you know, informed by the therapist. And, you know, from the offset, she was, you know, like, she made comments that, like, you know, she thought I was mature and like in all my thoughts and what, like, my reasoning for wanting to test. And, mm-hmm. you know, I know a lot of people who have tested and, you know, haven't had positive experiences. I've spoke to different people in the HD community and know that. So I know that obviously, you know, for me to have, you know, a process that was quite like easy and, you know, where I felt supported, it was really important. And I felt like it, you know, I think, you know, if you go through the process and you kind of, you don't feel like they understand you or like, you know, what you're going through and things, I think it definitely does have a negative impact, you know, on you and like for a long time. Whereas I felt like, you know, very seen and understood. And, you know, even though I was young, I didn't ever feel like she was ever questioning or doubting me, or, you know, there was ever any at any point where, you know, she wasn't gonna give me the result at the end, because, you know, she was very open from the start, you know, like how she felt about me and how my mental health was at that time and stuff. And, you know, she felt I had a lot of support in terms of family and stuff at that moment. And, you know, the whole process was, I couldn't really fault it. But the only thing that I would say is that, you know, coming out of the process, you know, it's kind of like you have all this support before it, but then you get your results and it's kind of, I don't feel it after it. I had the right support after it, but I did before it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, okay.
You know,
was it kind of like, oh, go ahead.
I was just saying, you know, like obviously if they were ever to change the process here in the UK, I think, you know, I would say it should be so many sessions before the results and then so many sessions after the results that are mandatory, you know. And I think that type of thing probably would have helped me, like, you know, just like process or like a lot of the raw emotions that I was feeling in that moment. Because obviously going into the appointment, it was kind of strange, you know, getting that result. I don't feel like in the moment I actually had processed it at all. And, you know, it took a couple of days and a couple of weeks afterwards for it actually for me to, you know, to sink in what they'd actually told me. And I think if they would have done the same amount of counselling after the results that they did before, I just feel like I would have probably benefited more.
Yeah, so it sounds like it kind of felt like there was a big lead up, a lot of care put into going into the process.
And then it kind of dropped off the face of the earth.
Okay, yeah. What was the process afterward? Did you learn your results and then have sort of a follow-up call or anything like that? Or was it just sort of you learned your results?
But then it was like, that was it really. It was just like, oh yeah, like kind of just like a bit of a check-in, whereas I felt like, you know, and, you know, obviously, like, probably at the time, I was, like, you know, adamant that I was okay. So I was probably on the phone today saying, oh, yeah, I'm fine. But in the moment, I probably wouldn't have been. So I think if it would have been mandatory to, like, actually, you know, attend, you know, because they say, don't you, you've got to, like, attend so many sessions before they give you the results. I think it would have been mandatory to, you know, sit down and actually just be face-to-face with someone. Sometimes I think if the call and, yeah, you can kind of feel, oh, yeah, I'm fine. Whereas if they see you face to face, you know, it's harder to hide those emotions. And, you know, I think it probably would have been very emotional for me to obviously go through those counseling. But I think it would have definitely been beneficial.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So it sounds like that was useful for you to be able to interact with the team. And that it may have been more useful to have more interaction after the fact. And that's good to know. Yeah. Did you have a feeling kind of going into testing that you would test one way or the other, like feeling like it was going to come back positive, or that, you know, you didn't really know that it'd be 50-50? How are you feeling going into the testing process?
It's weird because I actually spoke about this with my auntie, and like we both got our results at like a similar time. And it was, she said to me, because she come for the results with me, her and my dad. And she said, did you have a feeling that it was going to be positive? And I said, you know what? I said, it was weird. Like, I had an inkling before it. And she said she had the same. And obviously hers was negative. And she said going in, she just felt like, you know, it was going to be negative. And then they said it was. So, and I had the same, obviously, going in.
How did it affect you hearing that it was positive? Like hearing that, you know, essentially that in the moment, what did you feel?
It's hard. I don't think I felt anything in the actual moment. It kind of, you know, I didn't get upset or anything in the room, you know, and it just felt like, okay, because obviously I think because before I went in, I was expecting it to be positive. It kind of just was like, okay, get that, like that was expected. And then it wasn't until I got out of the actual room and we were walking through the hospital and I was with my dad and he just hugged me and started crying. And then obviously that's when I think it actually set in. And I remember that we were in the hospital and, you know, he was upset and then my auntie was upset. And it was like, it was just a very, very surreal moment to be in at that time.
Yeah. How's that been communicating with your dad about him having tested positive and then going through this process with you, you learning that you've tested positive, sharing that news with your dad? And that being sort of the moment that it sank in, that it was real. Over the last years, you know, kind of giving care to your father. Like, how has that relationship been? How's it been communicating with him over this time?
It's been a bit of a strange feeling because I know that Dad obviously blames himself, you know, for passing the gene on to us, but I never once thought that. And it's kind of like a crazy feeling because even though we both tested positive, I feel like it's been something that's brought us together closer. And it feels like sometimes like that me, you know, like that bond between us, like an unwritten connection that no one else kind of gets, you know what I mean? And, you know, a lot of the time it's made me want to fight for him more and maybe want to care for him more and make me just want to like remind him like that, you know, no matter what, nothing will ever change, like how much he means to me, regardless of the result or what happens to either of us in the future, he will always be my number one priority. And I think, you know, I've tried to make that clear to him and, you know, as best as I can. And I think in the moment, you know, it was nice to have him with me because you know, even though it was hard for him to hear that I obviously was positive, I think it was like, you know, we're together, you know, like we're here, we might be, you know, suffering, we might be going through a lot, but, you know, we still have each other.
How has that changed for you personally, kind of coping with learning that you tested positive for Huntington's disease over the years? In that time, it sounds like it was, you had steeled yourself. You had gotten prepared for this moment to learn these results. You sort of had a feeling that it was going to be positive and you didn't, you know, you were able to get through that, that moment. And then it was kind of hard to then share in that with your family. And that kind of, you know, goes with that up and down of being able to keep yourself kind of walled and, you know, protected, I guess I could say, like from being upset. But did you notice any sort of fluctuations over time with how you felt about testing positive for HD over those, you know, coming days, those months, those years following testing positive?
I think for a long time, it was like this really, really negative thing, you know, going on in my life. And, you know, for a long time, like I was just constantly worried about the future all the time, like thinking about the future and thinking about all the things that I would never get to do and the things that, like, you know, Dad would never get to see me do. And it just felt like this big tragedy. And best part of like 3 years after the result, you know, like it felt like a lot of darkness around me. And if to be honest with you, after the result, it felt like as if someone had given like put a sentence on my life, you know, like it felt like this very tragic thing. And it took a long time for me to kind of just go through those emotions. And then I think it got to a point where I was like, you know what, like this is just, I cannot go on like this anymore, you know, like I can't go on anymore. I like in this frame of mind and in this state of mind because it's just not going to get me anywhere. And I think I got to a place where I was kind of like, you know what, like no amount of worrying or tears or, you know, tantrums or like wishing that this is going to change, no one's ever going to change it. And I think you've got it. I had to get to a place where I was okay with the results, and I was going to start, you know, making me a priority in this in my life. You know, I think when you're a young carer, it's hard, you know, a lot of the time to put yourself as a priority. And I think for a long time, I felt like it was either putting dad first or putting me first, and it couldn't be. It had to be either one or the other. And then, you know, obviously as I got older and, you know, I started to understand myself and dad like more, and we, you know, our bond strengthened, and, you know, I kind of started to like learn, you know, how to care for him better. I kind of realised that it didn't have to be either or. Like, I could look after myself and, you know, I can make my mental health a priority, but while also giving dad the care that he needed. And I think it's kind of trying to find that balance where, like, you know, you're not, you know, I'm not depriving my needs and, like, you know, my mental health, and, you know, I'm looking after my body and, you know, I'm taking care of my body and all these things. So I think, and then, you know, once I started doing that and, like, you know, accepting, you know, what it was, I think it just kind of started to get to a place where it was, you know, it wasn't as heavy, and then you're like, you know, making it a priority that I was going to get up every day and, you know, choose to live and choose to, you know, enjoy the moment, even if it's, you know, not like all the time, like how people, like other people live, you know what I mean? But, you know, I made a, like, say to myself, you know, like, I'm going to have one day a week where I don't see dad, I don't do anything Huntington's disease, I'm just going to go, I'm going to do what I want today. And it was called myself Love Sundays, and like I'd go out walking, I'd go out hiking, you know, even if it was just like, I'm just going to go for a walk around the park and get some lunch or something, or, you know, catch up with friends. Like, I made sure that I had time where I was, you know, able to enjoy my life, you know, and just, you know, get back to the person that I think I was before the results.
Yeah, that's a really good thought. So how long have you been doing that, the kind of self days of no HD, just whatever else you want to do with your life?
I've been doing it for about, I'd say, three, four years now. And, you know, I had to reduce my hours in work to 4 days to kind of fit it in. But, you know, I actually thought in the, like, obviously, you know, in the long run, the drop in money was like worth it for me to prioritize my mental health. So, you know, after like a long back and forth, you know, like trying to figure out how I was going to, you know, bring this into, you know, my schedule with that, because obviously, like, it is, you know, it does take a toll on you sometimes to kind of care for someone for that long, like a lot length of time. So I ended up, you know, saying, you know what, I'm going to reduce my hours in work and put myself first in terms of, you know, my mental health, and just like getting active, getting back in the gym. I had started going on group hikes, you know, and like things like that. And obviously I love getting out in nature and, you know, meeting people and kind of just disconnecting from like my phone and social media and stuff like that. I think it's kind of nice to just go out and just embrace people, you know, meet new friends and stuff like that.
Yeah, absolutely. When we were talking earlier, we were talking about the process of seeking testing and sort of the support going into it, and then how that maybe changed a little bit afterward. It sounded like, how about outside of the, you know, I guess we could call it the clinical or medical system, like with your family and friends, did it also sort of feel like you had a lot of support going into it and that changed afterward, or did it feel like you still had that support with your family and friends and your network afterward, or was there sort of a difference there?
No, I felt like I definitely had that. That was a constant, you know, like my family and friends was definitely a constant throughout. And I think, you know, it's kind of, I've got a really big family, you know, me mom and dad are both 1 of 6. So it's kind of like, that's a blessing, you know, when you're kind of caring for someone, because it's always like there's always someone there, you know, to step in if ever I need like a step back or whatever. So I do think, you know, it is a blessing having a big family, but, you know, getting those results, it's like, it's not only affecting me, that positive result, it's like affecting everyone else in the family, you know, like every time, like there's another positive, it's kind of like, it does put a bit of like a bit of a, you know, a downer, you know, on like the entire family. So I think the only option we have really is to like kind of stick together and, you know, hold each other up through those moments.
Sure, yeah. Well, that sounds like a really good supportive family system, that everyone is kind of in it together and working together and kind of taking this on as a team. And good to hear that you have that. What would you share to anyone out there who's at risk for Huntington's disease and thinking about genetic testing, kind of thinking about undergoing the process? Is there any advice or thoughts or feelings that you would want to make sure that you either shared with them or that they knew kind of going into that process, into that decision of whether or not to test?
I think if I had any advice, it'd probably just be, you know, if they are thinking about testing, or, you know, it's kind of like, it's a hard decision to go through. And I think, you know, I would never say it was like easy, you know, an easy thing afterwards. Like I'd be quite honest and say, you know, I really did struggle. But even through all that, like there definitely is light at the end of the tunnel, you know, even though it is a hard process to go through, I think, you know, there definitely is light at the end of the tunnel, and you can find happiness and joy regardless of whatever that outcome is afterwards. And I think it's just kind of, you know, seeking support from as many people as you can. And I think for me, what I try to do it now, it's just making sure that the fear never gets to a point where it's overtaken, you know, my faith or my hope in terms of the future. You know, fear, I think it's a natural emotion, you know, to be in, you know, post results or, you know, pre results, you know, while you're obviously debating to if you're going to go through it or not. But it's like, that's a okay place to be in, but, you know, you can still be hopeful. You know, I still wake up every day and I choose hope, and I choose to embrace the future, and I choose to be, you know, optimistic. And I think, because at this point, like, you know, living with Huntington's disease, sometimes faith is all that we have a lot of the time. And I think if you lose that, sometimes it can kind of, things can get to be a bit of a dark place. And I think one of the biggest things that I actually has been, you know, such a, that I've found to be the most beneficial thing for me over the last couple of years was actually joining the HD community. You know, in the moment, I actually joined it because I wanted to help other people. And, you know, I wanted to share my story to help others. But in the process of that, I've actually found, you know, so many amazing friends through that. And actually having just like a couple of friends that you can, like, you know, that you know that they, like, they understand everything you've been through. You know, you don't have to sit there and explain your story or explain anything. And they just get it. And I think what I've found is that just having people who understand you, it means everything, you know. I have gone through my whole life really feeling kind of like alone and isolated and feeling like that no one really understands me, you know, around me, no matter how much they try, like they just don't really understand. And that's a hard place to be in. And I think, you know, it can make you feel really isolated, but just having a couple of friends who, you know, are living in with HD as well, it can make all the difference.
Yeah, how's it been having folks kind of come into your life that are either, you know, at risk for HD or have experienced their own experiences with HD through HDYO or through other avenues beyond? So I guess like having more perspective outside of your family, has that been helpful?
It's been so helpful. You know, it's like sometimes even when like I'm struggling or, you know, I'm feeling overwhelmed or just anything, it's like, you know, they're just a text away. And like, it's nice to just have someone who, you know, sometimes you don't even need to explain to them or say anything to them. And it's like sometimes that unwritten, you know, or unsaid things, it's like they still understand, you know, like what's going on in the background, even though you don't even need to say it sometimes. And, you know, since I've actually started sharing my story on social media and stuff like that, like I've had a couple of people reach out who live in Liverpool, and, you know, they've just found out that they have Huntington's disease in the family. So it's like they've reached out saying, you know, do you mind speaking to like one of our daughters, or like, you know, like in terms of, you know, they're thinking about going through the testing process and they just kind of need a friend who understand what they're going through. And I think sometimes it's not about what they say. It's just, you know, knowing that they can relate to you on a level that no one else in the world can.
That's great. So it sounds like getting connected with these folks has opened up opportunities for you even to kind of connect with others and share your story and how it may be affecting others that are in similar positions as what you were in previously, and kind of going through it together as well. So where you are currently, that's fantastic. Well, Robyn, I want to say thank you so much for sharing your story with us today. So again, this is a series called HDYou. These are stories told by and for the HD community. And Robyn has just shared with us her beautiful thoughts and story surrounding her journey with HD genetic testing. So thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.